silly to use the microphone, doesn't it? Well, welcome to First Presbyterian Church. Way to brave the ice this morning. We're proud of all of you. If it makes you feel any better, much more ice at my house today than here. So both of our cars were entombed in ice. The boys got them out of the ice. It's nice to have two kids to do that. So just a few announcements to get us started this morning. The first one is, I hope you all know this already, tonight is O Come All Ye Faithful, the concert here at 7 p.m. Come early to get a good seat. And for the kids who are singing in the choir tonight, please be here by 6 p.m. to practice and get ready for the program. Next, if you took a baby bottle to support the Alpha Omega Center, please return it to Galbraith Hall or the church office by Sunday, January 8th. And additional bottles are available if you would still like to fill one. Christmas Eve is coming up this coming Saturday. Worship will be here in the sanctuary at 6:30 p.m. Hope to see you all there. And if you can provide cookies for that, that would be great. You can bring the cookies that evening and give them to Judy Kerr, and she will set all that up for our fellowship time following worship. We're going out on a limb. We're going to try something a little different on Christmas Eve. We're going to have a bunch of white candles out, and we need some candle holders. If you have a candle holder that we can borrow on Christmas Eve, that would be great. Just bring it that night. We'll set it all up before the service. That would be fantastic. If you don't, that's okay too. We're trying something different. We're going to make it work. It doesn't need to look like anything. It holds a candlestick. We're going to have all kinds of different sizes of white candles. Any kind of candle holder would be welcome. We will not discriminate against any kind of candle holder next Saturday. How about that? Today, we are going to receive the Christmas Joy Offering. This offering supports Presbyterian-related racial, ethnic schools and colleges, as well as aiding church workers and their families in time of need. Also, we confused you a little bit, and we apologize for that. We will have worship on Christmas morning at 10 o'clock here in the sanctuary. Okay? It was publicized other places. We were thinking about doing it at 11 o'clock over in Galbraith Hall. Decided against that. We will be in here 10 o'clock next Sunday. So open your gifts early and get here to church. And hey, how about this? There will be no sermon next Sunday morning. Maybe that will be the thing that gets you in to come to church. And for you that like to sing Christmas carols, between Christmas Eve and Christmas morning, we're singing 14 of them. So no one can walk out after those two services and say, hey, you didn't sing my favorite Christmas carol. I think we're going to hit them all. So there you go. Following worship today, it's Popcorn Sunday, so we want you to pop in. But today we want you to pop in for a little extra. We're celebrating Steve Pryden. So come on over and say hello to Steve and give him a hug and have some punch and have some popcorn and have a good time. That's all for me. Let's worship God.
Thank you. In these last days of Advent, we stand on the threshold of Christmas. Our waiting is almost over. Through these days, we have experienced the presence of the one for whom we wait. God's presence brings peace. God's people of the Old Testament yearned for their Messiah. This is one of the promises that kept their faith strong. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. From Isaiah 9:6.
Jesus was born in a time of turmoil. Herod, threatened by the birth of the child that people were calling the king, wreaked havoc on the families of that time and place. It is difficult to comprehend, but there are many struggles around the world today where the powerful feel threatened and the innocent become victims.
But God promises that one day the fighting will end, that those who fight will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. The peacemakers will be blessed indeed. We light this candle as a people who long for Jesus and the peace of God for ourselves, our families, and communities, and for the whole world.
Let us pray. God of peace, this Advent, we wait for the birth of the Christ child, the Prince of Peace, and we wait for Jesus' coming again in glory when swords will become plowshares. We pray for those who live in conflict, that they will be protected. We pray for the situations that create conflict, and they will be resolved peacefully. We pray especially for the children who are hurt most by conflict. Protect them and bring caring adults alongside them to care for them. Show us how we can be peacemakers in our own relationships, our own families and workplaces, and in the world. Help us to be blessed as peacemakers in your name. Amen.
We come to worship the God who loves us, who sent us his Son. Please stand as able and join me in the call to worship as printed in the bulletin and projected on the wall. This is from Isaiah 40, verse 9. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, the herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up. Fear not, says to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Come, let us bless God's holy name. Let us prepare the way for the Lord to enter our hearts by praying together the unison prayer of confession. O God, our Heavenly Father, you have come to us in truth. We have come to you in falsehood. You come to us in faith. We come to you in doubt. You come to us in hope. We come to you in shallow expectation. You come to us in concern. We come to you in apathy. You come to us in purity. We come to you in sin. Father, as you have come to us, so would we come to you, humbly confessing the way that we are, eagerly anticipating the way we can be. Forgive us, God, and make us whole. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please continue your own prayers of confession in silence. Our assurance of pardon comes from Galatians 4. Please join responsibly. When the time has come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive the full rights of God's children. Because of our faith in life, death, and resurrection of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. In him we are God's children, are made one with him. Amen. As Christ has forgiven us, let us now offer forgiveness to each other by showing a sign of peace.
Please be seated. Good morning. Hey, is there anything happening next week that you know of? Special? What?
Christmas.
Christmas. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Christmas. That's next Sunday, isn't it? Huh? And by the time you get to church, you're probably going to have opened up a whole lot of presents, won't you? At least you hope so, huh? You know what's always seems sort of funny to me about Christmas, though? We know that Christmas is Jesus' birthday, but we get all the gifts. Don't you think it's his birthday? He ought to get some gifts, huh? Well, I brought something with me this morning as a gift for Jesus. Excuse me. And you see, I've got it in this very special treasure box because it's something, oh, I think Jesus is going to love this gift. It's just the right size. He's going to love it. I don't think he's going to give this gift back. You want to see the gift? Huh? Well, come here. Come here. You come here. Look at that gift. Huh? What do you think? Come on. I'll give each of you a chance to look. What do you think? Is he going to love that gift? Huh? Come here. Come on. One at a time, you get to look. You'll get your chance, don't worry. Ladies first. Huh? You see? Come on. I know you've been impatient. Come on. And you ready? You ready to see? For those of you who won't get a chance to look in the box, there's a mirror at the bottom of the box. And so when they look in the box, they see themselves. Because you know what? There's no gift that Jesus would like more than the gift of you. There's an old poem by a lady named Christina Rossetti, and it's set to some wonderful music that I'm not even going to bother you with singing this morning, but it says, "What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. But what I can, I give him. I give my heart." This year for Christmas, let's give Jesus the gift that he wants the most, ourselves. Okay? Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the gift of your Son. Thank you for all the gifts that we're able to give and to get. But help us in the midst of all that getting of Christmas gifts, not to forget to give you the gift that you want the most. Us. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, go back to your seats.
And now we come to the time in worship where God speaks to us through his holy word. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as these scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, that we may rejoice in you always and live in fresh expectation of hearing the good news of your coming again amongst us. Amen. I always like when this happens. This is now like the third time this has happened, when I get to be worship assistants and we do the 23rd Psalm. And as you'll see in the bulletin, it is responsive, which is great. So please join me in the reading of the scripture from the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The second scripture is also very common and very familiar to us at this time of year. It is from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20, which can be found on your pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along, or follow along on the wall. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you great news of a great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." And the angels went away from them into heaven. And the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
It is good to be with you again and to share with you once again what I believe God has called upon me to share with you. I've enjoyed this time at First Presbyterian Church in Newcastle, and I wish you all the happiest and most peaceful of Christmases. We pray with me. And so, God, be the center of our hearts, be the center of our lives, be the center of our thoughts this morning. Let nothing distract you, distract us from you. Keep us always in your grace. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We conclude today the series of Advent sermons that I've been sharing with you over the last couple of weeks. It's titled Witnesses to Christmas. In the last 2 weeks, we've talked about Isaiah and Joseph, and today we turn our attention to the shepherds. The night air was cold. The sky was clear. Stars shone like diamonds set on black velvet. Occasionally, the quiet would be broken by the bleating of a ewe calling after her young, or of a young lamb looking for its mother. But except for that, the quiet of the night went unchallenged. To the shepherds gathered there on that Judean hillside, just outside of Bethlehem, this night was like a thousand other nights that had gone before it. Here they were, the night turn of the local shepherds' union, wandering as working men and women have wondered ever since when their shift would be over. And so they looked from the stars to the sheep, back to the stars and back to the sheep again. Have you ever wondered or noticed, how much wonder stars hold for people? For some people, they are actually the objects of worship. For others, the symbol of hopes and dreams as they reach for the stars. Some people look to the stars for guidance in their everyday lives. And others look to them to see if they can discern something about the origins of our universe. But no matter what our degree of interest, it is true that for most of us, the stars, those little pinpricks of light which dot the heavens, at one time or another have seemed to reach out to each and every one of us and captured our imaginations. So it was on that Judean hillside a little over 2,000 years ago. Men huddled together, seeking to gain fire, both from the warmth and from each other's closeness, gazed at the heavens and wondered what significance those stars might hold for their lives. Not far from that circle of shepherds was the watchman. He walked back and forth, keeping his cloak gathered close to him against the cold. At times he stopped, distracted by the cry of one of the sheep, or maybe by a jackal's call far off in the mountains. The midnight was slow in coming to him, but at last it came. His task was over. His turn at the watch had come to an end. And now for a hopefully dreamless sleep. He started to move towards the fire, but then he paused. There was a soft light breaking around him, something like the moon, but then it deepened. Things before invisible came clearly into view. He saw the whole field and everything that it shattered. A chill, far sharper than the chill of the night air, gripped him. He looked up, and the stars were gone. They were caught all up in the intensity of a light that was dropping as from a window in the sky. And as he looked, it seemed to become a splendor. Then in terror, he cried to his brothers, "Awake! Awake!" Up sprang the dogs and howling ran away. The herds rushed together, bewildered. The men clambered to their feet, weapons in hand, ready to defend the flocks and themselves. "What? What is it?" they cried, as if in one voice. "See?" cried the watchman, pointing. And suddenly, believe it or not, the light became even more intensely bright, and they covered their eyes and they dropped to their knees. And then as their souls shrank for fear within them, they fell on their faces, blind and fading, and they would have died had not a voice called out to them from the midst of the light, "Fear not, fear not." And they listened. "Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of a great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign unto you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." Have you ever noticed how brave some folk are until they're faced with the unknown? Any one of these shepherds, if they had come face to face with a wolf raiding their herds or a thief making off with a lamb, any one of them would have known exactly how to react, exactly what to do, and they would have done it because they'd done it 100 times before. But here, confronted as they were with something new, here come face to face with an experience unlike anything they had ever had, they could only shrink back in fear and trembling. How much like you and me. Through the years, we've become so accustomed to fending for ourselves, to protecting ourselves, to doing everything to watch out for our own interests. We've become so accustomed to doing all of that on our own that we think we know exactly how to react in every situation that we know, and we know exactly what to do. And so we do it. But what happens when someone throws us a curve? What happens when things don't go exactly as we had planned, according to our own little set agenda? Don't we, like the shepherds, shrink back in fear? And isn't that the way we react when we first come face to face with God's will for our lives? Isn't there a tendency on each of our parts to say, but God, that's not how I'm used to doing things. I'm used to being in control. I'm used to putting myself first. Haven't all of us at one time or another said, but God, I'm afraid. I'm afraid to give up what I'm used to. I'm afraid of your expectations of me. I'm afraid of what you want me to do. I don't think I will be able to stand up under the strain of following after you. No, God, I'm afraid. Isn't that the way it is with all of us? And isn't that the way it was with the shepherds? Here was God speaking to them in a way to which they were not accustomed. And so they were afraid. Now, don't misunderstand. I'm not trying to suggest that these shepherds were godless men and that he had never spoken to them before. It's just that up until now, he had spoken to them in a very set and prescribed way, by way of the local prophet or perhaps the temple priest. And now, here he was speaking to them directly and through an angel. It wasn't God's speaking so much that frightened them. It was the way he spoke which caused them such great concern. And not until they heard that familiar old phrase, "Fear not," were they able to listen. "Fear not," the angel had said. "Fear not," God had said to Abraham, "for I will indeed bless you, and you will become a great nation. Fear not," God had said to Moses, "for I am with your mouth and will tell you exactly what to say and do. Fear not," God had said to David, "for I shall deliver the Philistine into your hands. Fear not," God had said to the shepherds, "for I bring you good tidings of great joy." Fear not, God says to you and me, "for in my beloved Son, I have conquered every reason to fear." Somebody much wiser than I, who has done some research and has determined that the phrase "fear not," or something equivalent to it, occurs in the scriptures 365 times. That's one time per day. God comes to you and says, "Fear not." So the shepherds rose and looked worshipfully up, beheld in the center the appearance of something like a man clad in a robe intensely white. Above his shoulders towered the tops of wings shining and folded. His hands were stretched toward them as if in blessing, and his face, well, unlike the face of the one who's speaking to you today, was serenely beautiful. The herald did not speak again. His message had been delivered. His tidings were told. And yet, he stayed for just a moment more. Then, suddenly, the light began to tremble, and then up as far as the eye could see, there was a flashing of light, the coming and going of radiant forms, and voices of a multitude singing in unison, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Not just once the phrase, but many, many times it echoed back and forth in the Judean mountainside. And then the herald looked up as though searching for the approval of one far beyond him. And his wings stirred and spread slowly and majestically. And he rose lightly and without effort, floated up out of view, taking the light with him. But long after he was gone, down from the sky in measures that were mellowed by distance, fell the refrain, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men," until it had faded away. Now, what do you think? If the shepherds had stopped up their ears, if they'd kept their eyes covered, do you think God would have forced his message upon them? I don't think so. And I think that's just the way it's going to be with us. If we refuse to listen to God, if we deny his power to use whatever medium he has at his disposal as a means of his revelation to us of his love, then we will miss hearing him. We will miss out on the message of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Then the shepherds said to one another, "Come, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass. The priests have been a long time telling us that God would send his Messiah, and now he is born, and the Lord has given us a sign by which to see him." And so they followed the light until it came and stood over the place where the child lay. And they went in and found Mary and Joseph and the babe asleep in the sweet-smelling hay. In a manger? Who would expect to find the Son of God in a manger of all places? And yet that's precisely where he was. And who would expect to find God in some of the places where we have found him? And yet we have found him in life, in death, in struggles, in sorrow, even in want. God has made himself known. And yes, we have even found God in the most unlikely of places, in one another. but we never would have found him if first we had not been willing to listen to what he had to say. And so the shepherds worshiped the babe. And having done so, they returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had seen and heard. You and I, my friends, have been led to this same manger and to this same child. Shall we not also worship him? For unto us as well a child is born, unto us as well a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and of the increase of his kingdom there will be no end, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Amen and amen. And so we come before God this day to return to him a portion of that which he has entrusted to our care, so that the message of the angels so long ago can be spread about in Newcastle, in Lawrence County, in Pennsylvania and Ohio, and even to the ends of the earth, that God has sent the Prince of Peace, even Jesus Christ. We wait upon you now as you bring before God his tithes and your offerings. Will you pray with me? God, what wonder fills our hearts that you would be willing to come and be a part of us, to know all of the temptations that we know, to experience the rejection that we frequently experience, though certainly not to the extent that you experienced it, to know hunger and want, to know everything that we've known and continue to know, to experience that, O God, when you could easily have in the person of your Son stayed tucked away in the glory of heaven. Our hearts are filled with wonder. Thank you, God. And thank you for those who are willing to share that love with others, for these offerings that have been brought this morning, some of which will be used to help your servants and others in need, to those that will sustain the ministry of this congregation, both here and beyond the city of Newcastle. Even as you have told us to go to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. So we dedicate those offerings, even as we now dedicate ourselves, Father. Hear our prayers, O God, for those whom we know and love who have special needs, and then move us to action to do what we can to help meet those needs. Help us, God, not to lose the baby in the midst of all the bathwater. Help us, O God, as that trite old saying goes, but help it to be real in our lives to keep Christ in Christmas. And as we seek to do so, may you receive all the glory and all the praise and all the honor. And having heard those silent prayers of our hearts, hear us now as we join, as with one voice, in the offering of the prayer which your Son taught his disciples when he told them, pray like this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The gift of God will cherish well that ever joy our hearts shall fill. And from that shall come indeed praise. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all, now and forevermore, world without end. And let all of God's people say, Amen.
Yeah.